Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you in the Holy Ghost. We worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we worship you in the Holy Ghost, in spirit and in truth. Just say, listen, let me say this to you. The Lord told us exactly what we would have to do if we wanted to hook up with the Holy Spirit. Showed us exactly what we had to do if we wanted to find ourselves functioning in this wonderful glory realm that the Bible describes, that everybody who's speaking in the Word of God declares exist. He didn't leave anything up, left. He didn't leave anything left to imagination or figuring it out. He told us exactly what we had to do. So if you would just begin to sing with me, Lord, I worship you in the Holy Spirit and truth. Begin to sing that, because I've discovered that if we will begin to agree with God with our words, that if we'll begin to agree with God, just like when we called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, we said something, words that He put in our mouth. If there's anything more wonderful than that, I don't know what it is. When I've always coveted that wonderful divine act that took place in Jeremiah's life, Ezekiel's life, Isaiah's life, the prophets, who were able to say, by the Spirit of the Lord, He put His words in my mouth. Today, tonight, in this assembly, God wants to put His words in your mouth so that you can do a work in the ministry. People want to do, look, I was just on the phone with a friend of mine who's, I just believe the Lord's going to use him in an amazing way in some of the doors that have recently opened that I'm not going to mention right now. But, you know, the reality of it is, we were just discussing, God's not going to do the things by the way that men think. Men think that if they can imagine a program good enough, if they can imagine an appetizer good enough, if they can imagine, you know, an advertisement good enough, then suddenly it's going to bring a change to people's lives. There are going to be more people come to the meeting, more people get saved, more people are going to be impacted. But that's not the way it works. God chose that by the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, through the weakness of men, even it could put it into a place of us almost being in a state of foolishness. As far as the world looks at it, and looks on us and sees, they could classify as a state of foolishness. They could classify it as a state of childishness. Total simplicity. Oh, look at those people. They're just saying words. God chose by the power of the gospel to change the world. I was talking with great evangelist today. God's just used him in amazing ways. And, you know, I we were discussing the breakthrough that's got to come in America without the fear of the Lord that used to be here in the 1700s, without a true understanding of the difference between iniquity and holiness, which used to be here in the 1700s, 1800s, when we talk about great awakenings and great moves of God. And the conclusion is just simply this: well, we just continue to preach. After looking at all the problems and all the issues and all the challenges, we just continue to declare the word. And I'm saying that to you as an individual. You've got to understand. You have to understand. You know, look, stubbornness and rebellion and doing it your own way. Well, let me just say this. Doing it your own way is a form of stubbornness and rebellion. You understand that? You could say it's not as much stubborn and rebellion as I've seen in somebody else, but still, nonetheless, it is a degree of stubbornness and rebellion, because it's going to keep us from ultimately doing it someone else's way. And the someone else that we want to do, the way of we want to do of someone else is the way of the Father. And He's come to pour out His glory upon our lives. He's come to resource us to go to another level. Okay? You can hear people who are financial, business savvy people talking about developing financial portfolios to be able to function at another level. It's true. Everybody right now, if you look at it from a financial world, you function at the level of your finances. You are limited to operate in the realm of your finances. It's the same way in spiritual. You are limited to function in the layer and realm of your spiritual understanding and ability and resources. So when you're hitting your head against disappointment, you set that ceiling. God didn't. When you're hitting your head against the same old problems, it's a ceiling, right? You stand up, you think you got room to move around now, but bang, you just, huh? You're like, wait, when do I get freedom to jump around? Now, after so long a time as this, harden not your heart. But listen, hear the voice of the Lord.
All you need to begin to do is to find where the anointing is. How many of you recognize that there is a manifest presence of the living God right here, right now? There's manifest presence. There is. Okay. Now, all I need to do to now participate and to experience and to benefit from that manifest presence of the Lord is to cooperate with what He's doing, to imitate what He's doing. Now, if we give you the microphone and you come and stand up here, it is our responsibility to imitate what you're doing, to connect with you. If I don't want to connect with you, I am by virtue functioning in an opposition against the anointing, against the Holy Ghost. How then are you ever going to be able to increase? Huh? Because you can pray all you want, you can fast all you want, but until you're willing and empowered to hook up with the anointing, nothing's going to happen. Tonight, I want you to understand that you're certainly being empowered. You don't have to go look for where the manifest presence is. For me, I can hardly see some of your faces, because for me, the manifest presence of the Lord is very thick in the place. I personally am very hungry for more. I'm happy to have this. I would not be comfortable without this. This is the comfort zone for me. This is the glory realm that gives me the ability to lift my head and speak. But I want more, because I know there's more available. I know Father wants to do more. So I just want you to, begin to get, somebody says, I want you to get positive. I want you to get full of faith. And I want you to understand how faith comes. It comes because you begin to imitate God. You begin to say what God is saying. We are not going to say, mountains come and strengthen us tonight. We're not going to say, bank account strengthen us tonight. If we did, you could just file out. You would never have to repeat that. But we are going to say, Holy Spirit, come and strengthen us tonight. And we want to say that with one mind and with one mouth, because that's what God said to do. That's what God said to do. He said, with one mind and with one mouth, glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He told us that this is what He's called us as the church to do, to mind the same things, to speak the same thing, to be perfectly joined together in love. That's what He told us to do. He's left nothing to the imagination. He's left nothing for us to figure out. He's told us exactly what He wants us to do. And if we're willing to do exactly it the way He said to do it, then we're going to get His results. Okay? Now, we know that Father's not going to receive any worship unless it's done in spirit and in truth. So we're saying, Holy Spirit, come and strengthen me. Holy Spirit, come and empower me. Then we start singing things like, Lord, I worship You in the Holy Spirit and in truth. You may stand there and think, you know what? I'm not worshiping Him in spirit and truth. I don't feel nothing. All I feel is whatever. If that's the case, I hope that's not the case for anyone. But if it is, I believe that with a sincere heart, you letting God put His words in your mouth. See, these are His words. He said He longs for and is looking for those who will worship Him in spirit and truth. So I'm not going to say, oh God, how can I worship You in spirit and truth? That would be faithless, wouldn't it? And Father's never going to honor anything other than faith, is He? True, He's not going to honor anything other than faith. So how does faith come? Faith comes by the Word, by declaration of the Word. How does your faith become powerful and effectual? You begin to speak His Word. You begin to declare His Word. So we sing, Lord, I worship You in spirit and in truth. Go, you can go ahead and you can play. Just keep playing. Just keep playing the same song.
Lord, I worship you in spirit and in truth. Jalala jalala mengere de mandala nenge de mamana na mandera. Jalala na nende bra mama mangede ninan jandu setira. Oh Lord, I worship you. Come on, son. In spirit and truth. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. I worship you. Mama nande brananga. In spirit and in truth. Oh, mighty God, oh Lord, I worship you. La samba mando, in spirit and in truth. Come on, a little faster. Oh Lord, I worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh God, I worship you. I worship you. Oh Lord, I worship you. In spirit and in truth. Holy, 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 holy is the Lord. Blessed is your name, Lord. Bebe la seke, bebe la soto, mama, debray. Holy, 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 holy. My Lord, I worship you. In spirit and Mama Nandela Angel, I worship you. Zalala Mamba Malane, Jebra Mamba Mandela Mamalane, Govra Mamande Roman, Sri Mamma Mandele, Roma Mangela, and a Mandero Manjo, the Mamba Rama Mandala and a Mangelo, Gore Mamando, Sri Mandela and a Mangale, Shara Mamala and a Mero. I worship you, Lord Jesus. Shira la la manda, dolo la mengora. Shira ma ma mandira ma ma na 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 na. Holy, holy, holy. Sikra mama mandam bla bara nan breve vele no mandore si dana na mangera mamandero. Oh, blessed is your name, Lord. Oh. Hallelujah. Ura mama mandero, mama mandero. Ura mama na 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 mandera, mama mandero, mama mana nenga nchora, mama mama lo lo mama mandera, mama mandera, mama nendele yolo. Kora bebe, mama mandela mandelo, mama mana na 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 mama brobo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ora mama mama ndere mama ndele na mama ndero. Sire mama mama ndere mama mama ndero mama ngale na ndala na mama ndele na mama mandolo lo barre na na sala na mbira. Baba mama no no mama mure bebe be kuso to roma mama ndero mama mangende la mana mala no roma mama la ne se la ga I worship you. And I'm going to do it that way forever, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. And I'll do it forever, Lord Jesus. And I will worship you forever, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worthy is the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Ora mama mandera samba bangendera mamandero sitilai. Zela la la manda, zela la mangero, zera vave mamanenelo. Zera vavanda la 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 mambera mamandero mongojoro mamandereve. Zela lo mambarebe, kushala la la mambravas. Hallelujah. Blessed is your name, Lord. Blessed is your name, Lord. Blessed is your name, Lord Jesus. Blessed is your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed is your name, Lord. Blessed is your name, Lord Jesus. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship and praise your holy name. Just lift your voice. Say, Lord, I worship you. Lord, I worship you. That's it. Lord, I worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, I worship you. Blessed is your name, Almighty God. Blessed is your name, Lord. Holy, 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 holy. Hallelujah. God, I'm Rabaneshe. Oh, Ramamandi Remando. There is a place called the realms of the spirit. Oh, won't you enter in? Won't you take hold of him? There's a greater opportunity than you have ever realized before. Take hold of God. He wants to pour out more. He wants to fill you up to overflowing with a glory, with a supernatural power divine. He wants to give you this wonderful thing called heaven, where Jesus is manifested in your life all of the time. Oh, just worship him. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. Woohoo! Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. For your presence, this glory of your love. Thank you, Lord, for your presence, this glory of your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. This mighty anointing. Blessed is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Almighty. Blessed is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Almighty. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. For your presence, this glory of your life. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for your presence of this mighty anointing. Hallelujah. Lord, in your presence there is joy. In your presence there is joy unspeakable. Hallelujah. And that joy I can feel, filling up my soul right now. This joy unspeakable. Oh Lord, in your presence there is joy, and it's joy unspeakable. And it's filling up my life right now. This joy unspeakable. Oh Lord, in your presence there is pleasures evermore. Woo-hoo-hoo. And these pleasures I am feeling overwhelming me right now. Hallelujah. Oh, in your presence there is fullness. There are pleasures, yes, pleasures forevermore. Hallelujah. And these pleasures are overwhelming me and filling up my soul. Ooh. Ooh, hallelujah. In your presence there are pleasures. Woo! Of the pleasures forevermore. And these pleasures I am feeling, they're overwhelming my soul. Hallelujah. In your porosagida mondaya. Manayre mandolo suki ataya remember si preka do no bara. Zayete onandayete anamangete. Malayo no monjekarina ma esaprabo yanayena. Baya tu yananeshe. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving our soul. Oh, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for making us whole. For making us whole. For giving us your great salvation. For giving us your great salvation. So rich and free. For giving us your great salvation. So rich, hallelujah, and free. Sabayero, sabayadoya, sabayetena, zobagitoto, zaprabetela, zoprocopano, zoprabekele, zopradusoto, mandela sikeo, mandela sabaya, mala sabayeto, supayeteo, mamandela. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus, for making me whole. For giving me your great salvation, so rich, so free. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all you've done for me. For all that you have done for me. Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for making me whole. That's it. Praise Him now. Hallelujah. For giving me your great salvation, so rich, so free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Come on now, lift your head. Say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Say, Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. And I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
Now I want you to sing it louder. I know that there's your voices. We're not going to sing soft. And I know that your voice could carry much louder than that. I want you to say, Lord, I thank you that you my glory and the lifter of my head. If you need to take a drink of water to get it going, whatever you need to do. Just go ahead and do that. Whatever you need to do. If you need to do a couple of exercises to get it going, a couple jumping jacks, push-ups, whatever. There's a realm of the anointing that you can reach into as well. But whatever it takes, I want you to begin to lift up your voice with your heart. Because if you will, God will resource you tonight so that you can function in a greater realm of the Spirit. Father, He's not going to make you wait a week. He's not going to make you wait a month, a year. You're not going to go through 5 years of training. There's no time for that anyways. It's now or never, basically, is where it's coming down to. The people who've got it are going to go with it, and the people who don't are going to stay at home. And so it's time to get it, because we need to go with it. So I want you to begin to stick it on. I want you to take a mambarade. This is better than drinking water right here, better than push-ups, whatever. I want you to just lift up your voice and begin to shout to the Lord. Sing, Father, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, Lord, art a shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, oh Lord, art a shield to me. Yeah. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Lord, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah, you're my glory and lifter of my head. Oh God, oh Lord, are a shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, you're my glory, the lifter of my head. Oh God, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh thou, oh Lord, are a shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, oh Lord, art a shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, oh Lord, art a shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, oh Lord, art a shield to me.
You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah, you're my glory and the lifter of my head. Oh, thou, oh Lord, I receive to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. And that's the way it's going to be now throughout eternity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. Rejoice, take joy in what you hear, and let me be a sweet, sweet sound in your thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving our soul. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for making me whole. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus, for giving to me your great salvation, so rich and free. Just lift your hands to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Lord of glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord of glory. Oh, Lord of glory, my glory. Thank you, Lord. Just lift your voice with a hum, or with the tongues, or with the words. Oh, thank you, Lord, for your glory. Your glory, Lord. Mamanandi Ramamandan. Your Ramande Chadonombe Ramande Donum Jeneng. Hallelujah. 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 The fire of your presence, Lord. The great outpouring of your Spirit now. Oh, the fire of your presence, Lord. The great outpouring of your Spirit now. Oh, the fire of your presence, Lord. The great outpouring of your Spirit now. Hallelujah. The fire of your presence, Lord. I want you to lift your head towards heaven. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. I know some of you are tired, you're exhausted, you gave your best to whatever it is you needed to do today. Well, your God's going to give you strength now so you can get some best to Him. Huh? Listen, church time is not the time for you to be worn out. If you need to take a nap in the middle of the day, then do it. In Jesus' name, from this time forward, amen.
So you can come into the house and participate in the meeting. Praise God. Come on now. Hallelujah. 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 Father's got so much He wants to give us. There's so much He wants to do through us. We can't afford another day of deferment. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to pray in the Spirit till the strength comes. I want you to worship in the Spirit until refreshing comes. I want you. Whatever's been in your way, I remove it out of your way right now in the name of Jesus. Anything that has harassed you, anything that has tormented you, it's out of the way. Hallelujah. 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 Be strengthened by the Spirit now. Be strengthened by the Spirit now. Mamangalesh to paro nombre de. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, that's, yeah, that's it. Hallelujah. 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 Just be filled right now. Hallelujah. Be filled right now. Be filled right now. Hallelujah. Be filled right now. Be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled right now. Yes, Lord Jesus, we love you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Karama mamonde deste karanande de deya tanana nenga danangalo sopo. Siarama mamama nenele le sene nengandolo lo borre memeni. Hallelujah. That's right, just go away in the Spirit. Just go away in the Holy Ghost. Just go away in praise. Go away in prayer. Go away in the song, the hymn. Go away in the melody. Be raptured, be translated. Be caught away in Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yeah. Yeah. You know, you can have church all by yourself. Just think about what it's like when you have in church with other people having church too. The house of God is filled with the praises of His people. The praises that can only come by the power and working of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ah, grandma, mama, neo. Caramama mandia la la mangecali alla lo mondo ya prever ayere ya bede yo ya tirebeki alla nondo ya sarre mama mande prever mama nondo ya breve lo mondo lo baiele quero manda la sura mamba do brava bebere ya reveo. Thank you, Lord God, for your mighty love and grace. Thank you for your mercy filling up this place. Thank you for the great outpouring of the Holy Ghost and power. Hallelujah. Stir up the gift that is in you. Stir up the gift. Stir it up. Stir up the gift. Stir up the gift. Stir up the gift. That stir up the gift. Stir up the gift. Stir up the gift. Stir up the gift through adoring Him and worshiping Him and magnifying. Stir up the gift. Stir up the gift of the Holy Ghost. Mama na na maleoro, mimna mama mandeiro, masikare di aleleo robo. Segaro mama mandeiro, si ala la mandevo, bosso fa bebeiro ma. Ora mama me breve vedeo, se breve babacora na na na. Segaro mama mandeiro, mama mando con la mano gale. Serra mama mamangera mamandololo sidende Segarra mama mandoro mama mandere ningadele Segarra mama mandero mama mangere namane godosh Segarra mama mangere shiano no mandori mama negere ngondo mana segala hana he mana hore dia ha Zoro namahare si ala loho tohora Nina na here magi to show you. Come on now. 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 Come, baby. Come. Urama mama mandeira. Kibanana na mandeira. Susana na mangueira. Urama mama mandeira. Nuningala na mangueiro. Kirama mama hahala. Serabaya yabaya yalariya toya. Serabaya yabaya yalalabaya lalomono. Say ala baye baye ala bado mama mane mama lohu brama nene gara sarme shila la la manana sirre bebe bebe rima Jesus, Lord Jesus, in Jesus name, in Jesus name, in Jesus. Jesus. This is where all sickness and disease and oppression has to go. The anointing will break off the yoke from off of you. As you're just worshiping and as you're praising, as you're giving thanks unto the living God, as you're not allowing anything to stand in the way spiritually, nothing else can stand in the way physically or financially or materially either. You find yourself just rejoicing in Him, enjoying Him, touching heaven. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just lift your hands towards heaven now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the atmosphere of your life change right now. Let the atmosphere of your life change right now. Let the atmosphere of your life change right now. God wants to change the atmosphere of your life right now. He wants to fill you with every good thing that belongs to heaven. He wants you to actually experience heaven right now. That's what He wants, and I want you to agree with what He wants. That's all. Jesus. Father, tonight we vow ourselves to live only in righteousness and holiness all the days of our life. To walk with You in the realms of the Spirit of holiness, to do Your will, Father God, so that every good thing that You purpose for our life might be realized in our lives. For Lord, all our desire is to be with You, to walk with You, to know every good thing that You provided for us in Christ Jesus, to no longer be entangled or ensnared with things that are going to hold us back. And Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that tonight every one of Your people will recognize that this place is where Your army is raised up, and where Your army is formed, where the people that stand and speak on Your behalf are brought forth with divine power and ability as they stand in Your presence and worship You. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Well, you can be seated. Just go ahead and be seated. I'd rather stand here and pray in the Holy Ghost and worship until I see everybody get a breakthrough. You know, I think that the worst thing about sin and is the condemnation that it brings. And if you got anything going on in your life that would anyway make you feel condemned or feel guilty or feel separated anyway from the Lord, you want to get rid of that out of your life quickly. Because you want to have the enjoyment of an uninhibited interaction with the living God. Dear people, listen, I think that for the most part, most of God's people do not realize how Satan has advanced his agenda right now in the society, in the culture in which we live. I want you to understand, there is more witchcraft and demon power worship going on right now than I'm certain most of God's people have any conceptualization of. And it's a good thing. I would hate that anyone knew too much by firsthand witness exactly how immoral, how demonized our culture has become, how much the children, the young people, well, probably can't just limit to that. All age groups are being impacted by what's going on the television, on channel networks like the MTV and all these other popular networks that most children and young people are watching. It is steeped in demon worship. Somebody said, oh, well, it's just about their, somebody's, program of advertisement. No, it isn't. It is the stronghold of demon power that they would only be able to participate with and would only know about because they are deeply immersed into a satanic stronghold that ultimately is going to be fully manifested when the person, the Antichrist, is revealed. And the spirit of Antichrist was around in the days of Paul. He spoke of it. John spoke of it. The spirit of Antichrist was around in his day. And That has only increased in intensity. We live in a society that really is more than ever before. I know that revivalists of the past said that we live in a godless society. But when we look back on the history now compared to where we're at right now, they did not have a godless society. They had a very moral society. We now are approaching in a realm of a godless society that very few people understand even what's going on. They don't, and then what's even worse is, as it were, you've got the epicenter of that immorality and that ungodliness, and then moving out from that epicenter or ground zero, if you would, then there is the fallout that's permeating all the way into the seats inside of the churches, into the homes and the lives of God's holy people. And there's only one remedy, there's only one possibility, and that is that a change. There's only one remedy, one miracle provision that God has right now for the people of this nation and for the nations of the world, and that is those that are in the church that will rise up with the power of the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. And the only way that is going to happen is that there are those ministers, pastors, apostles, prophets, and teachers that are gathered together that are dedicated to showing God's people how to touch the realms of that wonderful grace that has been given. And of course, for those ministers to be able to do so, they themselves have to be dedicated and committed to that realm. And tonight, Wednesday night isn't just another night. It's not like Tuesday night. If we were in the meeting house touching heaven together because of the great need and the destitution of the hour and the perilous time that we're living in, then Tuesday night would be a great night as well. But this is Wednesday night. This is the night that we have set aside to do this thing, and we got to recognize all the hindrances that come. It's not just here. It's everywhere. It's all across America. There is such an opposition against the anointing. There's such an opposition against God's people moving out of the realms of just knowing about God into a dimension of knowing God. You know, if you're going to be resourced to be able to do more in the realms of the Spirit, then you're going to have to get richer in the anointing. That's just all there is to it. God has given to every single person in here an anointing to know Him. God has given every person that has been born again that's watching me by way of the web or by YouTube right now, He's given them an anointing to know them so that no one has to teach them. The one and most important singular thing that you and I are supposed to abide in Christ Jesus. It's there. That's our only life. Listen to me. Without abiding in Christ Jesus, you are dead in your trespasses and sins. Without abiding in Christ Jesus, you have no life or power of God within. Without abiding in Christ Jesus, you're on your own and you're going to have to give an account for everything that you've done wrong. You have no help from above. You would be alienated and separated from God and from His love. Abiding in Christ Jesus is something that is essential. Father has made a wonderful work of grace. He brought to us the ability to be able to be completely transformed by the power and working of the Holy Spirit that we need to model to our children. And I can see a great deficiencies everywhere of where God's people are modeling to their children a whole new realm of living, because there's just too much acquiescing to the spirit of Antichrist, to the strongholds of the occult. And I'm talking about demon worship. Listen to me. Ultimately, at the end of time, when this whole thing gets wrapped up, it will be all centered around demon worship. Listen, the whole thing that Satan fundamentally wants is to be worshiped. He will set up a system to where ultimately we see in the book of Revelation, Daniel also saw it, where all the world will come and worship a demon, worship demon power. It's called the beast kingdom or the eighth kingdom. It's the last kingdom that will stand on the earth before Christ Jesus comes with 10,000 of the saints that Enoch prophesied about, of course referred to by Jude. He's coming with the power of His glory, with a sharp two-edged sword that proceeds out of his mouth, and with it he will slay the wicked. And that is in that realm of the eighth kingdom, when Daniel saw a stone that was carved out and was cast down and smote the beast, the image that he saw with respect to all of the kingdoms of the world that existed before his time, during his time, and after his time, to the very last kingdom before Christ Jesus comes and sets up his kingdom. That final kingdom, we call it the eighth kingdom. It's the eighth kingdom demarcated by John in the book of Revelation. And that kingdom is all about satanic worship. And what people don't realize, it's about Lucifer himself being worshipped. It's all centered around interaction with angels of darkness and with demon power to give them the ability to interact with Satan. And the world is fast pressing on that very day, that very event right now. And you don't realize it, you're being influenced by it and you're being affected by it. And there's only one way out of it. You're going to have to learn how to touch heaven by the access that has been given to us by the Holy Ghost. That's all I'm doing here tonight. That's the only reason I'm in San Diego, California. That's the only reason that God has given me an ability to stand in this place here. And the place that we're getting ready to move to by Sunday, right over there. By the way, side note, we need a bunch of help Thursday, Friday, and Saturday to get moved. And then Richard Moore is going to be here on Sunday morning and Sunday night. And then on Wednesday night, Brother Joshua is going to be here from the House Church of China. And every night Jesus is going to be here. And God the Holy Ghost wants to do more with your life. I take my job assignment very seriously. God told me to perfect saints. He said, I gave you as a gift. I've empowered you with a gift. Now to perfect saints, therefore go with authority to do it. And I know what I demand of my own house. And I know what God demands of me to demand of his house. Because I see what he demands of his house. What he wants of his house. And the reality of it is you don't realize this, but you're stuck to the majority of the degree in your life. You are stuck in your own opinion. You are stuck in what you believe. And I'm sorry to say that. I can get stuck in what my own opinion, and I can get stuck in what I believe. And the only thing that might make the difference between me and you is I'm going to be broken before God, crying out to God, saying, God, I don't want my opinion. I don't want what I believe. I'm desperate for you. And that is a critical factor within our lives so that we can jump out of the realm of where we get stuck in our own ideas and concepts. We can't see. We'll be blind. Our whole sight will be a blind spot to what's really going on. The only light is the Word of God. God has left nothing to imagination. He's left nothing to us jumping to some other conclusion. He's told us exactly what we got to do to connect up with Him, to function in the realms of divine power and authority. That's what I'm here to minister. I'm here to minister that in very practical ways. And we're going to... We're going to be long-suffering and patient. And, you try to be a pastor. Try it sometime. And you will discover that it is very challenging. Try to be an evangelist. Try to be an evangelist. See, the biggest problem with true pastors and true evangelists and true apostles and true prophets and teachers is they've got a heavenly vision. They know what God wants to do. And seeing what God wants to do and what's going on many times is completely diametrically opposed to one another and so far apart from one another, they aren't even similar. And that produces a great passion and a great tension within the framework of God's people. And, if you read back on what happened in the Great Awakening back in the 1730s, 40s, 50s, George Whitefield, he did some radical things. I mean, he would stand up and say, he's talking to the Lord. Lord, is there any Baptist in heaven? The Lord said, no, there's no Baptist here. Lord, are there any Methodists in heaven? No, there's no Methodists here. Lord, are there any Anglicans in heaven? No, there's no Anglicans here. Lord, are there any Catholics in heaven? No, I don't have any Catholics here. Lord, any Methodists in heaven? No, no Methodists here at all. He would go through these kinds of things, offend everybody in the house. Huh? Because you would make an heaven based upon what denomination? The only people that are here are those who have been born of the Spirit. Who experienced the miracle of the new birth. Who became a new creation. You go through all this exercise. And they wouldn't allow him in any... They wouldn't in America. They would not allow him to preach in churches in America. He had to go and take fields. He had to go preach in fields. Everybody was against him. And he was willing to stand there in that place until the event took place where God said, look, I'm going to come speak on my own behalf while you're talking. And that's when a great awakening began to shake this nation. Hallelujah. The same thing's got to happen. God plucks up, man. People just want to fit in. Oh, come on, man. I don't want to be pluck up ministries. I want to be fit in ministries. There's no place to fit in. Dear people, there's no room to fit into this world. There's no room in this world for Jesus. Not from the beginning, not now, not ever. There's no room for him in all the palaces of this world. There's no room for him in any inn. There was no place for him. He had to be put outside in the place of the outcast in the backfield in a cave somewhere in a manger. There's no room for him. Somebody said, well, why did God go ahead and make provision for Jesus so they could have had a comfortable reception when they got to Bethlehem, so they could have been nice and cush? Because God wanted to show everyone there's no room for him. He doesn't fit into the society of men. And I know I want to minister some things to you tonight that the Lord's laid strongly upon my heart. And I pray in Jesus' name that you hear. The more that I could get you connect with heaven in worship and singing, then the more then that you can receive as we minister. I'm going to tell you this. There's sometimes the anointing's so strong on me, like tonight, that I'm concerned about worship. I'm concerned about singing. You listen to me. Those of you, there's preachers who listen to me right now. They know exactly what I'm talking about. Because all of a sudden, people start worshiping and the anointing, the manifest presence, goes away. Now that's weird, isn't it? You hear me? And everybody's just doing their best. Bless their darling hearts. They all doing their best. But the manifest presence goes away. Yeah. Because people, you don't understand something about God. And you want to get this. He don't like any make-believe. He's not going to be around make-believe. He just wants truth. You can stand there and say, God, oh wretched man that I am. If it's true, you're going to have God there. You know what I'm saying? And then he'll be providing an opportunity for you to get right. But, you know, if you're standing there saying, oh, holy man that I am, and you wretched man, he's not going to do it. If you're acting like you love him, if you're acting like you praise him, if you're acting like you're worshiping him, there's not going to be manifest presence. Then I've got to, you know, then I've got to go through the tension of that thing. And I've either got to rebuke and correct, or I've got to get past it by praying in the Holy Ghost to then go ahead and try to deliver a word. But the reality of it is God's only going to deliver the word that the heart is prepared to receive. Can you hear me? Can you understand that? God will only deliver the word that the heart is prepared to receive. Do you understand that? Father has purposed to take this place, the abiding place ministry, and it doesn't matter. Father doesn't care if he saves by fewer or by many. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to Father if it's you know, 10 or 10,000, what he's going to do is he's going to have it right. What matters to him is it being right. And so that's why, you know, we'll spend a great deal of time just talking to you about lifting up your head, putting your heart into this thing, you know. Don't let anything stand in your way. And I believe for the most part, I believe that there are some times where people come in here and they harbor sin in their life, because if you harbor iniquity in your life, in other words, you like it, you're going to go back to it. You say, Lord, I'm sorry, but you harbor it and you want to go back to it. The Lord shows you a consecrated life, but you don't want to live a consecrated life. Then ultimately your heart's not right with God, and Father's not going to, you know, that's going to be an offense. You're going to have to get rid of that. And then ultimately in the house of God, every person supplies some kind of ministry. You have an impact, no matter. You have an impact on the meeting. You don't have to worry about having a negative impact so long as you want to have the right impact. So long as you want to have the impact God, the Holy Ghost, wants you to have, he's going to make sure that everything is functioning right in your life so that you can have that work of the ministry in your life. That's why we're come to perfect the saints for a work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, because each person in the body of Christ is supposed to be functioned in the realm of the anointing, so that just not, you know, Christy every once in a while getting up and ministering a prophetic song, a few other people getting up and ministering a prophetic word here and there, but everybody, where that becomes like a fire that begins to burn, it becomes contagious, and you get past the intimidation, you get past the guilty thing that's going on in your life, a sense of inability or whatever it may be, and you get so filled with faith. Faith is the only way to please God, and faith produces for you. Faith will produce boldness, assurance, and it will produce confidence. Faith is so important. Faith, we want you to be able to profit from all that Father's made available. Profit in every area of your life. Not just in finances. I mean, my goodness, it's amazing how much of the airways are devoted to people talking about everybody prospering financially. Look, people need to prosper emotionally. People need to prosper physically. People need to prosper spiritually. The most important riches on the planet that needs to be expressed right now is the anointing. I'm telling you right now, listen, when you and I begin to function in these works and greater works, it can't be hid. Can't be hid. It cannot be hid. It just all will ultimately will result in that. I want to, before I start ministering tonight, the things that the Lord's laid on my heart, I want you to understand something. The Lord isn't interested in you whispering a prayer in the morning and whispering a prayer at noon. He's not interested in that. He's interested in you lifting up your voice and crying out to Him. Amen. He's interested in a prayer that sounds like thunder, that sounds like rivers. And so, you know, you and I, we can't give it. All we can give is whisper. That's all we can give. That's the human side of things. But what God can give is He can give a thunderous anointing where the issues of that prayer and intercession are like rivers coming out of our innermost being. I want you to give yourself to what the Word of God says. I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, too many people have left what God wants to their own imagination. The Lord has not left anything for you to draw conclusions about what you need to do or to try to discover. God's not left anything for discovery. He's told us exactly and specifically what we are going to have to do if we want His results. Now all we need to do is just be obedient children and imitate God and do what we read in the Bible. How hard can that be? You can't. It's not that hard. In fact, it's good. Huh? It's good practicing being happy instead of being sad. I guarantee you, it's good just giving yourself to loving people instead of walking around in hate and strife and all the rest of the mess. And I can go on. It's good to walk in peace instead of to walk into division and strife. Amen.
Amen.
So let me just read these couple of verses of Scripture to you real quickly. I believe God wants to touch your life tonight in such a way that you're able to be resourced to function at a greater ability in God. I heard a wealthy businessman talking today about the fact that he's stepping into these other financial resources so that he can function in another level in business. And is that true? In finances, you know, you can only go so far operating on the $1 million level. Suddenly you get pinned into a place that you have to have, you're going to have to function, operate at a $10 million level, and everything has to be different, and so on, and so on. And it's that reflects the realms of the spiritual. It's true, and you must listen to me tonight. You're not going to be able to do more than what you've received from heaven. No man can do anything unless he first receive it from heaven. And God has not withheld from anyone. He's no respecter of persons. It's just that there are some people who's willing to do it more exactly like God said to do it and give themselves more time to cooperating with what the Holy Spirit wants to do to teach us and instruct us than others. And that's all that makes, that's the only difference. People think that somehow somebody had an opportunity with God and almost it kind of gets reduced like God liked them more or something, or they had some kind of they were born with some kind of additional affinity towards the Spirit and their spiritual things, and therefore that's how they've ended up as they are. None, that's all nonsense. The new birth is a leveling ground. God makes no distinction between Jew and Gentile or anybody anymore. He's made everybody one in Christ Jesus, giving every single person the same opportunity of Christ Jesus' inheritance and of the anointing. The only difference is some people are more earnest about it and therefore are going to give more time to it. Some people are more aggro about it and are not going to be stopped by nothing. Are you listening to me? And I want you to get aggravated at the devil and every hindrance. And I want you to get completely aggressive and radical about pursuing God. Father wants us to be radical about pursuing Him. So I want to read this verse of Scripture to you here in Ephesians chapter 6. And I want it to stand out to you with underlined red ink, or whatever is real bright to you, in exclamation marks. The Scripture says, praying always in the Spirit with all prayer and petition. Praying always in the Spirit. Paul described what it means to pray in the Spirit. Did everybody hear what verse I said? That's verse 18. Praying always in the Spirit. In other words, praying always in the Holy Ghost with all prayer and petition. People just go right off to praying with prayer and petition, just praying out of their own imagination, praying out of their own mind. No, God says pray with all prayer in the Spirit, okay, in the Holy Ghost. So that's why Paul said back in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, what shall we do then? We will pray with the Spirit and we will pray with the understanding. Praying in the Spirit always precedes the correct kind of praying in the understanding. Well, he said, what shall we do then? We will sing in the Spirit and we will sing in the understanding also. And singing in the Spirit always precedes the right kind of singing with the understanding. It gets you hooked up with the anointing. That's why Jude also said, build yourself up in your most holy faith. We want you to profit in the things that belong to you in your inheritance with Christ Jesus. We want you to profit in the realms of faith. We want you to see faith go to work in your life and change everything about your circumstances, about your finances, about your physical realm, and most importantly, about the spiritual dimension of what you're allowed and able to do and function in. God wants to increase the capacity of your ability to function in Him. He, as the psalmist said, He wants to enlarge your heart so that you can receive more. He wants to enlarge your heart so that you have a greater capacity to move in the Holy Ghost. And so you're going to have to go ahead and mind the things of the Spirit. If you'll sow to the things of the Spirit, then you're going to reap an unlimited life. In God, Father has made us His family. Praise God. Amen. Isn't it awesome?
Yes.
I mean, that was an opportunity for you to shout, but I don't want you to shout unless the shout comes from the spout of the Holy Ghost. Because that's what happens. We're like looking at people. I mean, you know, we're wondering, why is it that deep doesn't call on the deep? Why is it that people are aloof from the activation of the Spirit? There is an activation energy. In chemistry, we talk about an activation energy. And the biological, biochemical science, we talk about an activation energy. There is truly an activation energy that by the power of the Holy Ghost will touch your innermost being, but you've got to be able to be spiritual enough, or at least submitted enough is a better way to say it, so that that can touch you and impact you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, if a minister starts ministering to you by the Holy Ghost, you're going to get happy. In the ministry of music, in the ministry of the Word. And ultimately, you're going to feel the effect of the anointing. And that's wonderful. And God's made it and designed it that way. But what Father did was He gave that ability to be able to cause you to recognize what's available to you, so that you personally can begin to have that at home, and then that can be developed in your life, and then you begin to sow into it like you would sow into anything else. You go in and you sow into your job every day because you're expecting to reap a paycheck at the end of the week. You're sowing in expectation, and I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to raise a fuss if you don't get that paycheck. And that's just the way it works around your money, right around your stuff. think about how you guard your stuff, because one day God's going to put you, God's going to weigh you in a balance. He's going to say, this is the way you felt about your stuff, and here's how you felt about mine. I hope that that's, I hope it's not an equal balance. I hope it's far more weightier on the side of the things that God's made available to you. People, you need to get aggressive about the things that God has promised to you, and not let Satan rip you off and hinder you, not let things of this world and this life distract you, but recognize God will not be mocked. He's not a liar. If you sow to the Spirit, you will reap an unlimited realm, immeasurable, without any limits realm of life. And that life we're talking about is in the realms of the Spirit. Now, we need to see people raised up in this place who know how to give themselves to intercessory prayer. We need to see people know how to. We need to see people who know how to come under the Spirit of prayer and supplication, and will go to prayer for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hours. Who can be woken up in the middle of the night? And I'm going to tell you right now, maybe this is happening to some of you. Maybe, and you don't know what to do. But if you get awakened in the night, and you're troubled, get up and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. And you pray in the Holy Ghost until the peace comes. Because you don't know why you're troubled. And only the Holy Spirit knows. So you don't just have to start walking around feeling bad and pacing the floor and wondering if you set everything right on your income tax return or whatever. You know? And that's not what it's about. Papa wants you to start mining spiritual things. And if you do, then all of a sudden you wake up troubled. You know that God is calling on you because He knows you'll get up and you'll pray. You won't sit there and try to figure it out in your mind and wrestle it out in the framework of your own intellect. You're going to take it to Rusta Paranamradai. You're just a vessel. You're just an instrument. You're just a place where God dwells. Hallelujah. And God can move you at any moment, at any time. And then you just get up and you pray in the Holy Ghost. You won't lose any sleep. You'll feel better when you wake up in the morning. I guarantee you. You'll sleep the whole lot better. And you just and then sometimes it will then result in you beginning to pray for somebody because someone's sick or someone's in trouble or there's some need somewhere or some event. I'm going to tell you, you'll be able to start marking the calendar. Get your calendar out. Mark it on the calendar. Hey, God woke me up this night and I just prayed. I don't know what it was about. And then later on, He'll actually show you. He'll connect the dots for you. And you'll be able to go back and look and you say, okay, Lord, you can wake me up anytime in the night that you want to wake me. I'm available to Papa. Okay? I'm available to Papa, and usually by default, Angela's going to have to get up with me. Hallelujah. And then she decides whether she needs to make tea or whatever. But more importantly, she just gets in the Bastakara Stoda Makadista Tadadadadadosa Dika Lambaras Talalan today. And we stay at it. And God's got the time clock. And you know what we know the time clock is? You know when we're done? We know when we're done. Peace comes. It's total tranquility and peace. The burden is gone. The concern is gone. But how about if you lived all day in concern? What if you was walking around with concern all the time? You wouldn't know when concern came. Concern is a normal state of being for you. God wants you to live in Holy Ghost peace so that you can discern concern. Are you with me? Hallelujah. And then you know when the peace comes. Once you have prayed a sufficient amount of time by the Holy Ghost, because I don't understand prayer. But I know it works. I don't understand the dimension of why God has left us to participate with things coming out of our mouth to change things on earth, but He has. And you might as well get through the program, quit trying to figure out, because you ain't going to figure out God. No. You ain't going to figure out nothing about God. It ain't going to make any sense to you. And the more you try to make sense out of it, the more confused you're going to become. And Paul said they wrestled the Scripture to their own destruction. So don't do that. Just be a little child, agree with God, and let Him have His way. And one day He'll show you how He formed the universe and spoke galaxies into creation and how all these things work, by the way. Hallelujah. But until then, just pray in the Spirit. Amen. And until then, just agree with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Now that we all agree that I'm here by the Holy Ghost to perfect you, then you're going to be happy to be perfected. Amen. You're not going to feel like, oh no, He's picking on me. No, He's perfecting me. Amen. There's a huge difference between the way you look at, He's picking on me. No, perfecting me. He doesn't like me. No, He loves you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of you wanted to run away from home because your parents corrected you? I did. I packed my bags every other week. My mama used to help me pack my bags. I didn't like the way things were going around the house. I said, I'm leaving home. First time I was going to leave home, I remember I was 5 years old. My mother helped me pack my bag. She said, you think you need anything to eat? And I said, I don't think so. She said, I think it's so. She made me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I got my suitcase. I walked out the door. I walked down the block. I sat down at the end of the block. I ate the peanut butter and jelly sandwich and I came home. And I wanted to leave home because I got spanked. I got corrected and I needed to be corrected. Now, that's nothing for anybody around here. I hope I didn't give any little guys any ideas. Everybody be happy staying at home. Besides that, now it's a much worse time. You can't let your kids go down the block with a suitcase. No telling what's going to happen. I want you to open your Bibles now. Hallelujah. To Ephesians chapter 1. And this is one of the most important verses of Scripture to me. I don't care how much I read this verse of Scripture. You know what happens? Every time I pass by the Scripture, it literally jumps off the page and starts dancing around, and the heavenly choir is singing, "Hear the word of the Lord." Truly, lights go off, lightning flashes, everything happens on me on the inside spiritually when I read this verse of Scripture. Hallelujah. In verse 4 of Ephesians chapter 1, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blemish or without blame before him in love. And if there's one other verse of Scripture that I want to read just before I get in this ministering, just briefly on things that the Lord's laid on my heart to say, it'd be Colossians 1, chapter 22. Colossians chapter 1, 22 tells us that Jesus has presented you and me right now in the body of his flesh through his death. He has presented us right now holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in his sight. And if there's any other verse of Scripture that I'd like to read, and I'm going to read just before I start talking about what I'm going to talk about, it would be Romans chapter 5. And I want you to turn there with me, Romans chapter 5, and I'll just break into it at about verse 15, and I want you to hear something. I want you to hear God's love. I want you to hear God's mercy and hear God's grace in this. He says, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one man many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not as it was by one who sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is by many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more now we which have received abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in this life by one, Christ Jesus. And you just think about his love and his mercy right now abounding unto many offenses. You just think about if we sin, we have a mediator, an intercessor, an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. We could just think about the reality that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. It doesn't default back to the same place that Adam found himself in, having to wait for a redeemer, for there's no other sacrifice that is given. If we'll walk in the light as he is in the light, if we'll just give our soul, our whole heart and desire over to be in his people, praise God, then the blood of Jesus Christ continually cleanses us from all sin. We cleansed, we stayed cleansed, praise God. And we have this wonderful fellowship with one another, wherein Father is now doing this wonderful work in our lives, to where that everything that he's willed for us, everything that he created us to be, becomes a living reality. It's not skipping out on God anymore and leaving out and being trapped and being ensnared by the powers of darkness where there's no way for us to come back. Jesus is our access. The Holy Ghost making intercession for us. Jesus making intercession for us. I want you to think about this with me. God made a covenant with Abraham. He made a covenant and established it then with the children of Israel during the days of Moses, so he could give them the gift of holiness, so that he could give them a covenant, so he could dwell in their midst, so he could teach them to be his people. God created us to in his image and his likeness, and everything about our desires by design are his desires. And that has been twisted, and that has been perverted, and we've been ensnared by the powers of darkness, and we've been taught the lie to believe something entirely different about ourselves than who we are. God foreordained, God determined long ago when he created us, he determined that he should create us in his image and his likeness, and that we should share with him in his holiness, and we would share in him with him in his love for life, in his purity, in everything that is good and everything that is wonderful. There'd be no hate there, no murder, no strife, no division, no ill will. None of the things that you and I are so accustomed to seeing as common and ordinary, because we live in a world that is ruled by the powers of darkness. Father chose that we should be holy without blame, and now made a way to where that not only is a new heart, with a new heart through the miracle of salvation, we can begin to understand this, but we can also then begin to be developed fully in that manner of life by having his nature fully restored unto us again. But look at Israel. They hardened their hearts against God. They decided they just wanted religion. They just wanted to be in the club, so to speak. They just wanted the riches and the fringe benefits. They hardened their heart against God. They stiffened their neck. They wouldn't listen. He was there to teach them. He rose up, the scripture says, early every morning, reaching out to them saying, "Let me teach you. Let me teach you, there's a better way. In my presence is fullness of joy. In my presence is pleasures forevermore. Let me show you the paths of life. I'm going to tell you, I'll deliver you from death and the power of it. I want to show you the life that I designed. You were designed to have this life. You were not designed to have that demonic influence. Come, let me show you the life that I created you to have." And they hardened their hearts. And his mercy and his grace was such that he set up in provision of the coming Redeemer, a means by which their sins could be released every year. A means by which his grace would take care of their offenses and their iniquity, so that he could work with them and teach with them, teach them. And dwell among them and bless them with the gifts of his prophets and bless them with the gifts and manifestations of the Spirit, albeit it was very limited. But still, blessed with his presence, blessed to be his people, blessed with his protection. And you can see that as Balaam comes to curse Israel for Balak, king of Moab. And even though we know the state of Israel, we know how they were behaving themselves. When you get to Numbers 24, you know how they've been behaving themselves. They've not been doing what's supposed to be doing. They've been stiff-necked. They've been hard-hearted. I mean, God said it was before the event of Balaam, God had to remove his tent out of their dwelling and pitch way over off outside the camp from them because of their unwillingness to receive his presence and to agree with them. Yet, but he would not depart from them altogether, but continue to deal with them in his grace and his mercy. He's an amazing God. Amen. He's an amazing, merciful God who loves us in a way that you and I cannot even comprehend, because we've never loved like that and never had nobody love us like that. The only model of it is Christ Jesus. The only possibility of understanding is the work of the Holy Ghost in our lives. That's it. And the more, you're going to have to spend some time with God to get this, and there's no other way to get it. I can talk to you about it, but there's no other way for you to get it till you spend time with them. And even though they were so hardened in their hearts, so stiff-necked, so stubborn, so rebellious. Look at what he says to Balaam. Look at how he blesses them. Look at how he prophesies over them. Hallelujah. Look how he tells about who they are in the future and what he's going to bring to pass. Hallelujah. My. God watches over his word to perform it, because he's going to have somebody who's going to hear. I'm going to hear. I'm determined to hear. I pray tonight that every one of you have determined to hear. I pray that you've determined to be taught of God, you've determined to allow God to have his way, to allow the Holy Spirit to show you and lead you in the paths of righteousness for his namesake, to establish you in everything that God foreordained you and I to be in and to be.
holy, and without blame, in love.
Amen.
Look, he's Papa, he's the Father. He wants the family to be around him forever. He's a good father. I want my family to be around me forever. I want my family, I want nobody going away. I want everybody to be here, and I want everybody to want to be here. I don't want the strife. I don't want the rebellion. I don't want the hate. I don't want the animosity. I don't want the bickering. I don't want the murder. I don't want the Cain and the Abel scenario. That's what happens when any demon power is allowed in. People want to blame God. They want to blame people for the bad circumstances and situations that have occurred in their life. I'm telling you who to blame. Demon power. And make the demon power your enemy. And the only way that you're going to be able to deal effectively with that demon power is by the anointing. But here's the beautiful thing. God anointed Jesus Christ, to Jesus of Nazareth, with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all those who were oppressed of the devil. Because he has the power to break the yoke. He has all authority to cast out demon spirits. Every demon power, every devil in hell has to listen to Christ Jesus. And the anointing's teaching you and me to abide in Christ Jesus, because Christ Jesus wants to abide in us, and he has absolute power and authority. You want to get even? Listen to me. I got a better than that. This is more than getting even. This is absolute decimation of a power of darkness that has come to destroy you and everything around you. And Satan has his craft. He's tricky. He's a master of his craft. He's been doing it a long time. He knows everything about you, your father, your grandfather, your great-grandpa, all the way back to Adam. He knows everything about your weakness, everything about the design of your personality, your human circumstance, and he will manipulate that to his own will if you allow him. God will change you, take you out of the human condition, put you in the baptism of the anointing of the Holy Ghost, and he can't know nothing about you there.
Amen.
He can't touch you there. He cannot manipulate you there. Hallelujah. Hidden away in God. He has no more access into the realms of glory. It's not like it was in the days of Job anymore. It's not like it was in the days of Daniel anymore. He's cast out of that realm. He has no more place in heaven. Hallelujah. He's a spiritual wickedness in a heavenly realm, but he's not any longer, and that means a spiritual realm, an unseen realm. He's no longer standing before the presence of God. He's been destroyed. He's been, as Jesus said, cast out. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And nothing in heaven but heaven and glory and presence of God, but his holy angels and his saints. Praise the name of Jesus. And we want you to be able to enjoy that. It's going on all the time. You can come to the meeting anytime. Hallelujah. Well, you can come to the meeting anytime, in the morning, in the night. You can come to the meeting. There's a continual ongoing meeting that's going on in heaven. It's described by the Apostle Paul in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 22. It's continually going on. There's no reason that you should be out of it. You in a heavenly place in Christ Jesus. You don't need to be stuck in some earthly realm trying to figure things out, wondering what's going on now, trying to manipulate things, trying to hold on things, trying to arrange things. Put your trust in God. Let him take full control. Here we are now, and we're not so much unlike Israel, who God's presence abode with them 1,400 years, his long-suffering. Yeah, you know, we see the judgments of the Lord break out upon Israel. We see the judgments of the Lord break out upon Israel so that that generation who murmured and complained could not come in, but we see his mercies extended to the next generation, and they did come in. They said, we'll do all that you've spoken for us to do. We promise everything that you said for us to do, we will do it with all of our hearts. Whether we live or whether we die, we're going to obey you. That was their heart when they went in. It wasn't long, it wasn't many generations, and they had erected idols and turned their hearts towards idols. And yet God still pled with him. He still had mercy on them. They had so corrupted his glory that I don't even want to talk about the things that they had turned the glory of God into. They made him into a bull with that had the body of a man and the head of a beast. I mean, just all kinds of crazy things that they did. And yet he still had mercy, and he still showed his love, and he still cried out to people and said, let me teach you my ways. I have ordained you to be holy. and blameless before me. I've made a way so that I can interact with you. I've made a provision to be able to deal with your spiritual need that allow me to be able to come and lead you and talk to you and teach you and raise up my prophets and send them to you so that they can tell you about this life that I have and contrast for you how good things are in heaven versus the hell that you've been living. Now God has taken it to a whole nother level. Now God has taken it to a whole nother level. But how different are we from Israel? God hasn't changed. He's more dedicated than ever to declaring to us his faithfulness and his commitment to us. All we have to do is be willing. He's absolutely dedicated to bringing us. The one who began this good work is dedicated to the finishing of it. That doesn't mean there any kind of determinism. Determinism, the idea of determinism that ultimately God started to work and there's no way out of it. You can live whatever way you want to live. It doesn't matter. He's ultimately going to finish the work whether you are participating or not. That's nonsense. That goes contrary to everything that has been revealed in the Bible about God. There's a condition of obedience. God's not forcing anybody's will. He's not making anybody comply. You and I've got to be willing to. The beautiful thing of it is when the new covenant came, He gave us the willingness. He brought forth in His grace a miracle of salvation and gave to us something that Israel didn't have. A new heart and a new spirit to cause us to do His judgments, to write His laws upon our heart and upon our mind, to establish His ways on the inside of us so that inside of us there is this longing to do Thy will, O God. The Spirit of the Son is there witnessed in our life saying, Abba, Father, that's my dad. I want to be with him. I want to stay with him. I love my dad. I want to honor my dad. Are you with me?
Yes, amen.
My father's the best father that's ever lived kind of thing.
Yes, amen.
Hello. Satan comes along to separate you from Father, defile your conscience, create condemnation, create and cause all kinds of guilt. Listen to me, dear people, if you're single and you can't handle your problems with your physical body and the natural God-given desires that are given you, then take Paul's advice. It's better to marry than to burn. Listen to me. It's better to marry than to burn. Are you with me? Hello. Come on now. All right, hello. But you better get it. You better get mastery because God demands it. That's New Testament doctrine. That's not Old Testament doctrine. You can't walk in immorality of any kind. You're going to have to get hold of yourself in every area of your life. And now we live in a place where the occult, listen to me. Sexual immorality is not equivalent to murder. It's far worse. It's far worse. Sexual immorality is not equivalent to any other kind of sin. It's far worse. God says they did defile their body with fornication. He said, I will destroy them in hell. That's what Papa says. And Satan knows it. We don't understand it. We try to normalize it. Our culture has normalized it. Our culture has made it ordinary, has made it down, has put it on the level of something purely animalistic. Has made it purely mechanical. It's not. God created something beautiful that brings forth eternal life. Satan knows it. Satan understands how to destroy men's souls in hell. That's why the attack has come now. And it's on an ever-increasing level of when you look at satanic worship, when you look at where the whole world is going to worship the image of the beast, to worship demon spirits, to be a completely demonized and under the influence and interaction with fallen angels. Go read again in Daniel about the mixture of the clay with the iron, the 10 toes of the seventh kingdom. Well, not even talking about the eighth kingdom, but the eighth kingdom is mixed in with the seventh kingdom. The eighth kingdom almost seamlessly follows the seventh kingdom. It begins in Revelation chapter 12. In fact, I'm really praying about actually starting another series on Friday night after we're finished with Order in the House on the book of Revelation, because I believe people need to understand the clarity of the book. I see that a lot of people are stuck in the mystery of the book, and now I've been hearing more nonsense about how we're supposedly now, you know, in the 6th and 7th chapter of Revelation. Some people got us in the 6th trumpet. That's all nonsense. If there's anything that needs to be brought out and just broadcasted to the atmosphere, just our voice lifted up, is the sound doctrine of the word.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
But the bottom line of it is, and when you look at the 10 toes of Daniel's vision, you see it's iron and clay, because it's angelic angels trying to mix with men in the seventh kingdom. And we're not far from the seventh kingdom. And I can prove that we're not far from the seventh kingdom. The whole world right now is concerning themselves with Israel. And the scripture says that everybody who takes upon themselves the burden of Jerusalem shall be crushed to pieces. I mean, I need to start bringing these scriptures out. I need to let people begin to hear about what's ultimately going to happen. It's already laid down. You know what? You go to regular school, they give you history class. We give you future class. Huh? They can talk about the history, and that's all muddled. But we can talk about the future. We can lay it out for you. These are the events that our kids and our children need to understand these things. And we need to emphasize more the teaching of the Word of God than the teaching of this nonsense that is a ploy of Satan to snare the hearts and minds of God's people. And we sit around sleep. Oh, awake from that your sleep, oh thou that sleepest. That's what the Lord told me to say. In fact, that's what God told you to say. He said for you to go around and proclaim, "Oh, awake, O thou that sleepest, arise, and Christ shall give you light." Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm not mad. I'm just full of a whole bunch of zeal. I'm full of a bunch of passion, because I see what's going on. We need to wake up. And the only way we're going to do that, the only way we're going to have any result or any impact on what's going on beyond just talking about it, is we're going to have to be resourced with the anointing so we can have a greater effect in dealing with fallen angels and demon spirits. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Paul said so. He said, be strong in the strength of the Lord, power of his might. Be endued with the whole armor of God. Huh? When a warrior goes, gets ready to go to war, this warrior is not a Roman soldier. This warrior is God himself. He girds himself with his equipment, with his armor. God tells us about a special kind of Holy Ghost armor that has been made available to you and me. He said, be endued, put on the whole armor of God. Amen. This is what the Lord called us to do. We're supposed to be endued with Christ on a daily basis. We're supposed to be put on the mind of Christ. We're supposed to put on Christ Jesus and make no provision for the lust of the flesh to fulfill it. Huh? For the any dimension of those things that Satan would try to bring to ensnare us, to neutralize us. See, if you have confidence toward God, if your heart doesn't condemn you, you have confidence towards God, guess what you can do? Whatever you ask God to do. Could you turn this up a little bit? My hearing must be going down. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, every person in this place is going to hear this. This sound system can quit holding us hostage in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to get enough anointing to break the yoke off this sound system. And a big part of that is we're going to be able to get out of this big, huge hall and move over next door where the sound's going to be better. Praise God. I want to just encourage you, come help us tomorrow. Come help us Friday. Come and help us Saturday. We're moving everything over to the other building. We're getting ready for the ministry that's coming down. You know, Richard Moore will be here Sunday morning, Sunday night. And then on Wednesday night, Brother Josh will be here. And we just want to go ahead and start the meetings over there. We're looking forward to getting in there. I just felt when we moved on this property, Father wanted us over there. It took a miracle for us to get in that building as much as a miracle for us to get on this property. And we started with what we've got. And we'll just expand from there. We're going to let God do the work. Whatever he does, he's going to be glorified. I'd prefer to go to heaven. I have no interest on this earth but to do his will. That's it. I want you to buy in with this. I want you to buy in on this deal with me. Hallelujah. I want you to buy in fully to God. Father, we live in for you. We have no interest for ourselves. We'd rather be with you in heaven. As long as we're here, we'll do whatever he wants to do. Amen.
Amen.
In other words, we're just going to occupy till you come.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We're not going to be occupied. We're going to occupy. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father's given us this new heart. He's given us a new spirit. He's written his laws upon our heart and upon our mind so that he may cause us to do them. He's given us a nature change. As Zechariah said, as he prophesied in Luke chapter 1, verse 74, said, now for the rest of our life in 75, from now on we can live without fear. We can now live in righteousness, and we can live in holiness. all the days of our life. We're not going to live under the tyranny of our enemy. And he wasn't talking about the Roman Empire. Because they lived under the tyranny of their enemy before the Roman Empire. And he wasn't talking about the Babylonian Empire, the Grecian Empire. He wasn't talking about the Medo-Persian Empire. He wasn't talking about the Babylonian Empire or the Assyrian Empire or the Egyptian Empire. He's talking about the demonic empire, which the Lord Jesus says, for us to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, which will then all result in us being endued with the whole armor of God. That's why you have to learn how to understand that fundamentally what we're doing here is not trying to teach you a new song. I'm not trying to teach you no Bible verse for you to memorize. Hallelujah. My God, I'm teaching you by the help and the grace of God how to hook up with the Holy Ghost. Now, come on now. Amen. Let's get the right picture here. Huh? We talk about getting into a place of the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Now, you come on now. Amen. Father has left us in charge of this nation. He's left us in charge of this world. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care what threatening evil spirit tried to give a sneer at me. I knock it upside the head and stomp it underneath my feet. I've been given the authority, and so have you. And I'm day right now, I'm not going to give you any rest till you start doing some of that stomping in Jesus' name. Are you breaking off the yokes and breaking off the strongholds? Father wants you to understand, if your heart condemns you, then what, you know, my goodness, what are you going to be doing? But if your heart doesn't condemn you, if you're not allowing Satan to get in between you and your relationship with the Lord, whatever you ask, Father will do it. And then you find yourself vested with faith and power and authority to change things about your life. Hallelujah. To change things about other people's lives. Praise God. And when I say change things about your life, I'm specifically talking about no longer being hindered by the powers of darkness kind of try to bring you some kind of, you know, sadness or sorrow or disappointment or discouragement or whatever other mess they try to run interference as you're supposed to be lifting up your voice and shouting unto God, making a connection with the Holy Ghost, being filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. I mean, you really need to consecrate yourself. I mean, Father is consecrated to a realm of love. He wants us to be consecrated to that realm too. He wants us to be together. I mean, if you come on now, as a father, as parents, we want our children to be around us forever. Amen. We want to build a home for them and for the grandchildren, even more. And for the great-grandchildren, even more. I mean, I love my children dearly. And I find that the grandchildren are just even that much more special. I mean, they're all special. They're not that much more special. Mom doesn't like that at all. She's like, no, there's nobody better than my children. And so she's giving me the eye. She's giving me the mama eye right now, you know. Hey, don't you minimize the kids. But it's just emphasizing the beauty of it. It just keeps getting better, you know. And Father's that way. We have that in us because that's who Father is. We don't have that in us because that's who we are. Because we were designed by Him. And so men are running around the earth, imprisoned by darkness, trying to find the things that are deep inside of them that were placed there by design. Trying to find that place of love that was placed there by design. Trying to find that place of peace that was placed there by design. Trying to find that place of harmony and unity and world peace. I had this guy meet with me the other day. You know, he's an environmentalist and tree hugger guy and whatnot. And he was telling me how he's dedicated to world peace. And I just rolled my eyes and I said, it's never going to happen, buddy. I said, you guys can sit around in a circle and hold hands and think good thoughts for the rest of your life. Nothing's going to change. It's going to get worse. The only place that they're going to find peace is the Prince of Peace has come. Yeah. And the world is going to look for world peace, and they're going to cry for peace and safety, and they're not going to be able to find any. And then all of a sudden, there's going to arise that everybody's going to admire and think this guy's really got the goods, and he's not going to be the right one. He's going to look like a man of peace, and he's going to turn on them and he's going to destroy them, because that's the way Satan is. Yeah. He lures you into something that you think that you've got to have, that this looks so good. This is the answer. This is everything I've been looking for. And he gets you into the room and then turns on you and devours you. Yeah. Praise God, there's somebody who loves us here.
Yes.
I thank him for saving my soul. Yes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This isn't a make-believe. This isn't an ideology. I can feel His presence. I experience the impact of His goodness. This isn't some kind of philosophy. This isn't some kind of religion. There's a manifest glory of His working power in our lives. He's come and proven Himself, and He wants to prove Himself in a greater way through us to a lost and dying world. You and I have to hook up with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
We have to understand that this is only going to be a reality when something begins, we allow something to begin to be birthed in our heart by a greater response to the working power of the living God upon our life. I'm praying that intercessors will be raised up here. Where are the intercessors that used to exist in the church? You knew them. You could see them. They walked in the meeting glowing with the glory of God. They always were prophesying. They prophesied every meeting. They were the intercessors. They were the women who were devoted to keeping the home. And then when they and in keeping the home, they had devoted time where they spent hours upon hours in prayer, crying out to God. Holy women, where are they? Do they even exist anymore? I don't know. I don't know. I mean, honestly, I've seen so much crazy things. Honestly, you got to understand things from my dimension. I'm not going to go into all the bad stuff that I've had to encounter over the past 20 years that supposedly were intercessors. It was nonsense. It was absolute insanity, and then proven by evil fruit when they ended up in some immoral relationship with a church leader to be what it really was. A bunch of demonic nonsense, interference. We got to see strong women and strong men of the Spirit raised up again in the camp of the house of God, because people are willing to taste the things of heaven above the things of the earth. They're willing to be taught of God, led of the Spirit. They're willing to be trained up to be able to function in a ministry. Hallelujah. As a member in the body of Christ, having been given a manifestation of the Holy Spirit so that everybody can profit and be brought together. I don't see unifying powers. I see divisive powers. I see strife powers at work everywhere. And especially wherever there's an anointing, Satan persecutes that anointing, trying to kill it. There are so many churches that literally through discouragement and disappointment have closed down just over the past year. And they were anointed men of God, anointed churches that were continually being bombarded by accusing lying devils. They didn't know how to stand. They didn't have strong fathers in the faith around them. They didn't have strong network. They didn't have the roots of where the church has been and where we're going. And they gave up. They gave up after they heard so many preachers say, if you don't have at least 100 people in your church, close it down because it can't be a God. And then they've got to now start having all these folks define success based upon these thousands and even tens of thousands of people in your ministry. Give me a break. And they didn't say that. God didn't say wherever 2,000 or 3,000 are gathered together. He didn't say where there's 200 or 300 gathered together. He didn't say where there's 20 or 30 gathered together. He said where there's 2 or 3 gathered together. That's what He said. He brought that down to that level. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I had prayer meeting. I had service every night. It didn't matter if there was one person there or 100 people there. I wasn't doing it for men. I was doing it because God said, do this. And therefore, I was faithful to that which the Spirit of the Lord said to do. It wasn't just some kind of little whimsical dream or notion. It was God's voice speaking into me. And I was apprehended by the power of God and couldn't do anything else. Didn't matter how many people were there. Don't matter how many people were here tonight. Nobody can disprove me or prove me based upon how many people. In fact, I would rather say that the more that is there, it could be that it's a probability that it's wrong. Because narrow is the way that leads unto life. However, I do hold an exception to the moving power of God when revival comes and an awakening comes. The masses come in, but the wind's going to blow shortly thereafter. Hey, and listen to me, the winnowing fork of Christ Jesus is going to begin to stir the place. And people's hearts are going to be revealed to them. People are going to be offended by the word. It's true. Bubba sorted out. But everybody who's willing to stay and be taught His way, He's going to make sure that we're held in a place unreprovable, unrebukable. Hallelujah. Without blemish. And the closest word to without blemish or without blame that you can find is perfect. And I know people tremble, perfect. I just wouldn't just go without blemish. People get all weird about perfect. We'll just go without blemish because that's what we're talking about. Just go without sin. Blemished means that you have a spot of sin upon you. There's some imperfection about you. If the sacrifice that you brought to God had a blemish, in other words, it had a blotch of red on it where it's supposed to have been white, it's blemished. If it had a blotch, if it had a defect, if it had a little alteration in its pupil, blemished. Huh? It had to be without blemish. It had to be perfect. It had to be genetically perfect. It had to be the kind of animal that you would say, this is my prize animal. I'm going to use it as genetic breeding stock. Everything about it I want reproduced. That's the one the Lord accepts. That's the one He made you and me. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody said, how can that be? He made us in Jesus. Hallelujah. You don't exist outside of Jesus. You, listen, read my lips. Now, you won't have to. You do not exist outside of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Hallelujah. There's no life outside of Him. He that has the Son has life. He that possesses Christ Jesus. He who is born of Christ Jesus. Who He is born of the Spirit. He who Christ Jesus has been formed within them. He who has been born of God. He who has Jesus, Christ Jesus living in them, is alive. He that does not have Christ Jesus is dead. But they live. 1 John 5:11-12. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son. Does it say he who believes on Jesus has life? Because for John, he who believes on Jesus possesses Jesus. That is the doctrine of John, period. No one, ask a Jesuit, he will tell you that that is true. He might not believe in the results of it, but he's a studier of the word. Hallelujah. And there are Holy Ghost-filled Jesuits, believe it or not. Lakotomasatana, speaking in heavenly languages, laying hands on the sick, having visitations from heaven. Yeah, there are. There's Holy Ghost-filled Coptics. There's Holy-filled Greek Orthodox. There's Holy-filled Russian Orthodox. There's Holy Ghost-filled Armenian Orthodox and other Orthodox, the Orthodox Orthodox. Hallelujah. There's people who won't give themselves to what Pentecostals in America would do. There are many Orthodox people that don't believe that Pentecostals in America are even saved because of their manner of living and behavior of life. They say by evil fruits you deny him. You may confess him with your words, but by fruits you deny him. And you can't really argue with them. You're just going to have to conform in Jesus' name to the image of the Son. So we're not having unholy things in our life. People look at Mariah Woodworth Eder and they say, wow, look at the power of God revealed in life. Well, you also need to look at the consecration. She was consecrated to being taught of the Holy Ghost. She was consecrated to understanding a life of living in righteousness and holiness. She was consecrated to a separate life. Hallelujah. We separatist. Amen. We not of this world. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I see these people made fashionable signs. They started it back in the 80s. Not of this world. I first got real excited and I saw this car pulled out from a neighbor's yard and he had a sign, not of this world. And I said to the neighbor, I said, wow, praise God, you got a Holy Ghost person beside you, not of this world. That's wonderful. He's going, man, Bubba, he ain't that. No. That's a bumper sticker. It's too sad. We dilute everything with compromise if we're not careful. People, it's just time for us to recognize how devoted God is to us, and let's just be devoted to Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Look at how much He's willing to bear with us in long suffering and mercy as we go through all of our obstinance and all of our slow of hearing and all of our slow of heart. How much He bears long with us. Even when He's empowered us never to sin again, and yet we continue to go on doing it, yet He comes with His mercy and grace, and He continually cleanses us, and He continually forgives us, and His mercies are new every morning, and He won't stop so long as we're willing to be taught His way. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Is that amazing?
Is that amazing? Is that amazing? A holy God who has pure eyes and to behold evil has made a way for you and I to come be one with him, be taught of him. People, we can't take that for granted. We can't take that for granted. We can't be bored with that. We can't be too tired for that. We can't be, we too tired. We worked hard all day. Pastor, give us a break. What do you expect? I expect you better be filled with the Holy Ghost, otherwise you're not going to make it. I expect you better understand how to hook up with the anointing. The anointing to get you past your tiredness. And if I can teach you to plug into the anointing where you get past your tiredness, you'll also understand how to get past sickness, how to get past disease, and how to get past discouragement, how to get past disappointment, how to get past every other lying work that the principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in the heavenly realm has set themselves against you to destroy you and stop you from moving forward. You'll learn how to overthrow them. Amen. Satan hates tongues. Religion hates the language of the Spirit. Don't listen to the lies. Don't be polluted by the lies. The Word of God is very clear on it. God set the precedence on it. It's undeniable. It's unimpeachable. No one can any way overthrow the manifestation of the Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. They liars against the truth. Satan knows that if you learn and understand how to function in these things that he supplies in his grace to give yourself to living in this realm, he can't stop you, man. He can't stop you. You will have absolute mastery and total authority over all of his realm and walking in the ministry of Jesus, doing these works and greater works, going everywhere, healing all that are oppressed with the devil. Because you can cast out devils and command them to leave and go in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? That's what you have right now. You don't have to earn it. Any more than you had to earn your salvation, you don't earn the power to cast out devils. I give you power. That's a bunch of cross-eyed, don't hardly understand anything disciples. Are you with me? Are you listening to me? I give you authority. Huh? I give you authority. He's a bunch of disciples that don't know anything. On the day, on the most critical hour of the Lord Jesus, they all gonna run. They gonna run. I had a guy tell me, he said, he's a preacher's dad, he was a preacher, he was from Egypt. And he was telling me, you know, he's breaking bread with me one day in his house. And he said, when we go to Egypt, I just want you to know, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will stand with you no matter what happens. I will always be there. And as soon as the secret police came and grabbed me, he snuck away. I watched him run. I watched him slip into the shadows and run down the back alley out of the peripheral vision as I was being arrested by the secret police and had no ability to speak Arabic to any great degree. That's exactly what these disciples that the Lord Jesus gave all power and authority to did to him. He didn't earn this. He gives it. He's amazing. He empowers the least qualified. He's amazing. He doesn't empower necessarily those that everybody thinks he should have empowered. Otherwise, he would have empowered Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea. He would have empowered all the great men of the day. He didn't. He found lowly fishermen. The guys who were basically didn't have nothing else to do but stand around and watch John the Baptist baptize people. Who were just captivated by the anointing, captivated by the move of God. Those folks who were in church all the time. Those little folks, he said, come follow me. Amazing. Ignorant fishermen. Hallelujah. The least qualified. He takes the weak things of this world to confound the foolish, confound the wisdom of the wise, to take foolish things and bring those things which men call wonderful and powerful and wise to nothing. He gives it to us as a free gift. All we need to do is function in it. Hallelujah. Mambra nengande se preteya. Monombo shikara se prete.
All you need to do is just get past the condemnation, get past the guilt, get past the affliction, get past the disappointment, get past the discouragement, get past all those things that beat you down and intimidate you and make you fearful. Come on now. Some of you just need to take a nap on Wednesdays and between services just so you can function a little bit better at night. Because I know it's hard to function in the anointing when you're tired. Because you know why? Tired is an overwhelming impact on us physically, emotionally, and spiritually. It just causes us to die. We get knocked out by it. We go unconscious by this thing. That's how powerful this effect of sleep is. And that impact and that effect can have more impact and effect on us than the anointing. Especially if we don't really know how to plug into the realms of the anointing. We're just sitting there going. But there is a realm where you can touch heaven. No matter how tired you are, no matter how sick you are. Oh, no, we want you to learn this. No matter how discouraged you are, no matter how disappointed you are, no matter how overwhelmed you are, we want you to be able to practice when you're overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock, which is higher than I. Hallelujah. We want you to understand the impact of entering his gates with thanksgiving. Preparing your hearts. Don't just walk in here with having had a big conversation about what you had for lunch. Who really cares what you had for lunch? It is amazing to me how many people write on Facebook what they ate, take pictures of what. It is gross. To some of us, that is gross. That is like, you gotta be kidding me. That's like you taking a picture of your cavity and saying, this is my cavity. And this is what. Don't do that. Just leave it. Just leave it. And then you're going to come into the meeting. You just come into the meeting, just having talked about, and then first thing you want to say to the person beside you, oh yeah, sister so-and-so had such and such for lunch. That's not what the Lord's called us to do. He's just not saying. There's a sacredness, there's a setting aside our hearts and our minds and our thinking to participate with the things of God. It's just setting yourself apart from every other thing that is in the world. It's like a fast. When you fast, you set yourself apart from food. You set yourself apart from all other activities to just do nothing but pray and seek the Lord. When we come into the meeting place, we set ourselves apart from all the other distractions and all the other interests and all the other things that would try to plague our thoughts and captivate our mind and our thinking. All the things that you've got to get done, the list of things that you didn't get done today, the concerns of your life, all that stuff is to be set aside, because otherwise it rules you and you can't ever get out of it. It's a trap. Because the Lord wants to bring to us clarity of thinking. He wants to endue us with the mind of Christ so we can understand, wait a minute, that is a trap. I'm not going to deal with it after my own natural understanding. I'm now going to rise up in the anointing. I'm going to deal with it after the manner of the Word of God and after the faith that the Lord Jesus Christ gives me by the Holy Ghost. But if you don't enter his presence with thanksgiving, if you don't come into his courts with praise, if you don't participate with the Holy Ghost, knowing that what's going on in the house, whoever is leading, you're supposed to imitate them. You're supposed to connect with them and follow them. Otherwise, you're being obstinate. You're being rebellious. By just spite the very fact that you don't want to participate, you're telling the Holy Ghost, no, it's a stubbornness. It's an opposition. They're never going to succeed that way. You're going to walk out of the meeting having not received all that God purposed to supply. I pray that you believe with me that the fire of God will burn so hot in this place. There could be nothing here but truth. Number one. I pray that you believe with me that the wind of God will blow so strong in here that there will be nothing but that which is sincere and consecrated to the Lord in this place. That there'll be no room for anything else. You might have stumbled along the way You might have had all kinds of upsets and ups and downs, but when you walked in here, you walked in here with not a bunch of baggage of issues and offenses and criticism. You walked in here with a desperate heart to meet with God. That's what I'm talking about. The fire of God burning so bright, there's only truth in the place. The wind of the Spirit blowing so hard that there's nothing but that which is genuine and real. That's it. Because in the midst of that, a move of God can get started that cannot be contained. That will change people's lives. They will all go through a sorting out period, but I'm telling you right now, I want to see the thousands and the tens of thousands come rushing into the kingdom. God has purposed for that to happen.
Amen.
We need to see intercessors raised up. We need to see women and men of the Spirit raised up, who know how to function in gifts of the Spirit and bring them into the meeting and bring them into the meeting and bring it into the meeting. We need to get you to a place where you don't allow a bad attitude to come into the meeting with you, that the fire of God's able to burn in your life. You know what the fire of God does? First thing the fire of God does, burns up bad attitudes. First thing that God, the fire of God does, it burns up self-interest. That's what God's power, that's His presence does. That's why we want the fire of God to burn. Because it's those things that keep us from connecting with the Holy Spirit. It's those things that just, they disconnect us from the body of Christ so that we don't function as the church. Because the church functions powerfully when all the church begins to do a work of the ministry. Each person, my job is to participate with the Holy Ghost in a gifting that He's giving so that you can be perfected. Hallelujah. So that you may do a work of the ministry. So that the body of Christ may be strengthened, built up. And the body of Christ, Jesus, is the head of the church, which is His body. And the church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things. And that's a light unto the world. And that will change everything. It's time, once again, that there's wisdom and insight in the church. The world turns... Our government turns to the psychic because the psychic's the only possible person could know where the plane went down. Huh? Because the church has no power. But yet the church should know. Oh, the plane went down over there. Or the plane is here, or whatever. There was a time where President Eisenhower visited an old man in Los Angeles, a prophet of God, to find out what the enemy was doing. President Roosevelt. Because there were men who knew and heard from God. And you could take their word. What they said, what they declared, came to pass. They were men consecrated to God. They weren't mixed with all the stuff. They weren't watching Fast and Furious and then trying to get a word from heaven. You know what I'm saying? I think that's the name of this. Or was that some lawsuit or whatever? I don't know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Watch the latest movie. I think that watching Noah is going to be good. I think that watching Noah is going to be good. I'd say that everybody should support that just so Hollywood makes more movies about the Bible. But bottom line of it, I don't know what that's really going to turn out to be, but my goodness, I'm believing God for the best. I think it's pretty prophetic to start off with. I hope it doesn't end up pathetic, but you know. There just needs to be more praying saints. We need to be taking hold of God. You know, there was a culture where the practice was just to get on their face and pray and cry out to God. I did that, and I do that. I mean, I used to pray and cry out to God till my nose bled. Just down there in that position. I can't get in that position anymore because I spent so many hours praying with my head bent down. And you just try it sometime. A lot of pressure gets in your head. But you know what? The Lord just kept unveiling and revealing, wait a minute, there's an equal intensity of a place to get into in a manifest presence in the anointing where we can begin to participate in something that we were doing at the onset tonight when we begin to just worship the Lord with other tongues and people just begin to pray. If I could have just got, I kept seeing too many people being sleepy. And I figured, wait a minute, I want us to get to a place where half of us are awake and half of us are asleep. I want us to get to a place where everybody can participate. You know, everybody can just hook into the anointing And so we're just going to minister. I know the word of God will change that. We'll just keep doing this, but find a threshold when I start seeing people falling off, you know. I praise God for those who I saw getting more and more raptured in the anointing. How about when the whole of the place just gives themselves to that place of praise and that prayer to where the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the intensity of the manifest presence of God just increase and become stronger and stronger. Then out of that realm, we have a great influence in the realm that is going on trying to hide the gospel light from shining in this region.
Amen.
Oh yeah, believe it.
Amen.
Oh yeah, believe it. Oh yeah, believe it. Believe it. Yeah, believe it. Amen. And every time you give your thoughts in your mouth to offense and to arguing and to murmuring and to complaining and to just cursing yourself and cursing people around you because you don't like how things are going, you got a bad attitude, you're in allegiance with the powers of darkness stopping the church from going forward. That mess has got to stop.
Amen.
Good things, Father's long-suffering and tender.
Amen. Thank you, Father.
And merciful, huh? He's ordained you and I. He's ordained you and I. He foreordained. He determined that you and I should be holy without blame and love. Can you picture yourself there?
Yeah.
Can you picture yourself there in the assembly of the church? Holy without blame and love. Can you see yourself coming into the meeting? Holy and without blame and love. Can you see yourself in the worship service? Holy and without blame and love. Not just in love with God, but in love with everybody around you. Huh? And not out of just thinking love. Okay, I've just got to be in love. Okay, I love them. I don't like them, but I love them. None of that business. I can't believe what they did to me, but I forgive them and I love them. Nonsense. I'm not talking about that kind of love. I'm talking about a love that the Holy Ghost fills us with to where you can't see sin. It's removed from you as far as the east is from the west. You can remember it no more. That's what happens in the holiness of God. In His presence, in that consecrated realm, it's holy. It's a consecrated realm. It has no sense of sin. There is no sin. There's no sense of sin. It cannot exist. Not in the thinking realm. Not in the memory realm. Huh? Not in any realm. Hallelujah. It cannot come in. Hallelujah. Well, God wants us to be there. Holy. Hallelujah. In the holy realm. Without holiness, it is impossible. To see God. God wants us to see Him by revelation. He wants to see Him by knowing Him intimately. Because, you know, seeing is also a concept of knowing, right? The Lord wants us to be in this room. So let's just be dedicated. Let's gather together in our heart and our commitment and our prayer and our petition and our supplication before the Lord. Father, this is, we know what the church is supposed to look like. We're not depending upon the pastor to be the church. We don't have to just wait for him to tell us what the church looks like, because we're giving ourselves to understanding it for ourselves what the church is supposed to look like. And then when the Holy Spirit begins to minister these things, you hook right into it and say, yeah, I've been studying that. Yeah, God, the Holy Ghost has been showing me that. And now you just make a deeper and a greater connection with it. It becomes your prayer. Oh, God, let the church look like this, be like this. Some people measure the anointing based upon music. I don't measure the anointing at all based upon music. I measure the anointing based upon the manifest presence of Jesus. God's so interested in us here tonight. We, His people, called by His name. We're His family. We are born into the family. We're begotten of God. We're the household of faith. We're the household of God. Christ Jesus is our brother. He wants to have communion with us. He wants to have fellowship with us. The Holy Spirit demands truth in the inward parts. The lie has to stop. What comes out of your mouth is what's in your heart. If when you go home, you got something bad to say, you got criticism, that's in your heart. Your heart's not right with God. If parents hear your children doing that, look, you need to correct them. Children, you hear your parents doing that, look, you need to correct your parents. Even if you're 5 years old, say, Mom, Dad, your heart's not right with God. Listen to what's coming out of your mouth. And parents, don't think your child's getting rude because the Holy Ghost is talking to you. They need to hold you accountable because they think it anyways, whether they can articulate it or not.
Huh?
It's true.
Take children and interview them. If they're just honest, say, you can find out whether the parents are hearts right with God. What's going on in your home? Is there arguments going on in your home? Is there dissension going on in your home? Is there evil speaking about other people going on in your home? Heart's not right. Heart's not right with God. And then you want to try to worship over top of that? No, sir. Holy Ghost will not have anything to do with it. He will not have anything. He demands truth. All you had to do is be broken and say, I'm sorry, God. Just forgive me. I can't believe I did that. Holy Spirit, teach me your ways. I know what you want me to be. I know what you ordained me to be. Holy, without blame, in love. I'm sorry, oh God. How many times will he forgive you? 490 times a day, over and over again. He's right there with you. Teach you, lead you, guide you. He'll perfect everything that concerns you. You keep your heart that way. He'll make sure that you find yourself on that day, holy, without blame, before him in love. Unreprovable, unblameable, without blemish. Amazing, eh? Isn't that awesome? That's us. That's us. That's us. I go to Mamba Day Yadishapaya. It's wonderful when there's matured men and women in God, in the Spirit, who can look at people and not see them as they are, but see them as God has purchased them to be. Huh? Who has purposed them to be. Who can prophesy over them. Who can see who they are in God's eternal purpose and plan. Oh, let there come forth matured men and women of the Spirit who know how to walk in holiness, blameless in love, who walking in love, you're so concerned about everybody around you, hallelujah, that you're down on your knees praying for them, not empathizing with them, not sympathizing with them, because all that does is establish them in their wrong deeds and wrongdoing. Huh? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, but praying, interceding, because the anointing breaks the yoke.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And you know what? We may preach for 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years, but eventually the anointing will break the yoke. Has to. Because we don't give up. His word is like a hammer. Bam! Hammer. Bam! Hammer. Echoing throughout all the earth. Bam! Echoing throughout all the earth. It break the rock. Burst through the rock. Crumble into pieces. Hallelujah. They used to tell me about the highway department used to, before they had all the, you know, gizmos and whatnot, they used to have these certain little hammers. I don't remember what they were called, but they were little hammers. And they would be able to beat on a rock in such a way with this little hammer that ultimately huge boulders would collapse into gravel. Pretty radical, huh? Huh? Pretty radical, huh? Amen. Bang, 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 bang. Night and day. Bang, 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 bang. Night and day. Night and day. When we have a meeting, it needs to sound like somebody, a bunch of people banging on a door. Huh? Knock and the door should be open unto you. Hallelujah. It needs to sound like a bunch of people banging on a door. When we meet together, it needs to sound like a bunch of people seeking. Because they're going to find. Huh? When we have a meeting together, and he's going to be about a bunch of people asking, lifting up their voice unto the living God, and knowing at the same time that they are being fully empowered to do everything that God is pleased with. He's done all this for his own good pleasure. He gave it to us. He gave it to us after his own good pleasure. He brought us into sonship. Isn't that awesome? Be bold. Be strong. Huh? Here's how God wants to empower you. Here's how he wants you to feel about yourself when you walk out of here. Strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. Here's how God wants you to walk out of here tonight. He wants you to walk out of here saying, I'm strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. Huh? I'm telling you right now, those words have come out of my lips when I felt like it was all over and there was no possible way for anything to survive. It's done. If I would have given place to it, I would have just concluded that, you know, I lost out and failed. But I wasn't letting I lost out and failed come out of my mouth. You know what came out of my mouth? He put his words in my mouth. He put his words in my mouth.
His words. His words. It is just as powerful for you and I to take the scripture and speak it as it was for God to put his words in Jeremiah's mouth so that for the first time on the earth, the word of God could be heard as it was heard through Jeremiah's mouth. What an event, huh?
Yeah.
What a glorious event. What a glorious power. It's even more powerful to you and me to say, no, no, no. I'm going to let his word be in my mouth. I am strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. I shall do valiantly, for it is the Lord God who subdues all my enemies. Hallelujah. I shall run through a troop. I shall leap over a wall, for the Lord has taught my hand to war so that a bow steel is broken by my arm. All who contend with me, God himself would contend with. Huh? Just lift up your voice. And I never said that about a human being. Never. Demon power. It's terrible. Fall out in ranks with demon power. God's judgment is going to be in his house again at all my fear. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. I'll tell you right now, you step into the anointing increases in your life, and you allow sin in your life, you'll get sick and diseased. You will. You will. You will. You will. It's the act of mercy of God. Keep you back from the anointing. Huh? You get deeper in the anointing, you start talking about the anointing, you'll break out with leprosy. Your nose will fall off. You'll be walking around, everybody knows what you've been talking about. Your nose is off. Leprosy. No nose and no ear. We know what you've been doing. Huh? True. It's true. It's absolutely true. Don't look at me like that. It's true. I know what I'm talking about. I know exactly what I'm talking about. I come from a long line of people who knew what they were talking about in the realms of the anointing. I sit around and listen to this long line. And I'm not talking about from my own family. I'm talking about a line of ministry. Hallelujah. Listen to me. God's merciful and gracious. And so he holds back a lot of what otherwise would be here because we're just simply not willing to go all that way. But he continues in his mercy and his grace, listen to me, to deal with us. Let me lead you in the path of righteousness for my name's sake. Huh? That's fine. Let me lead you. Come on. Let me take you all the way over here into the realms of glory. Will you go with me? Uh-huh. Sipara, I'll give you everything. I mean, if you realize what all God would provide for you right now, you would take no thought for your life, what you should eat or what you should drink. If you realize all you have to do is understand how to participate with his conditions, you would cease from all your own works immediately. Huh? But that takes a walking with God and participating with God, a relationship with God, for that revelation to come, and then you just move right out in it. And so we're at step number one. Once again, the invitation, the call. Come now, listen. Interact with him. Come on now. Get happy with God. Come on now. Stay happy with God. Delight yourself in the Lord. Now, delight yourself in his glory. Or we say, delight yourself in fatness. This is another word for glory. Eat the sweet. Huh? Drink the sweet and eat the fat. Hey? Huh? Delight yourself in the sacrifice. Drink the sweet. Eat the fat, the real, you know, the real tasty marbling stuff, the marbled stuff, the real prime. Sweet. And the fat. Send portions to everybody who has nothing for them. Provided. Huh? Rejoice in the day, for the joy of the Lord should be your strength in the day of adversity. I know what to do in the day of adversity. Drink sweet and eat the fat. Huh? I know what to do in the day of great crisis. I know what to do. I'm supposed to recline. I recline. Like they did on the night of Passover. I recline. I relax. I get in a restful position. I get a cushion. I just relax. I cease from my own labor. Because the Lord will do great things tonight. Huh? I immediately stop. I shut down. Can you hear me? I'm talking about what you're supposed to be doing. Don't panic. Shut down. Rest. Relax. Say, it's all good. I don't care anything about this world anyways. I'm ready to go to heaven. When you don't care anything about your life, say, you can't do anything to you anymore. He can't threaten you anymore. You don't count your life dear unto yourself. I don't care about my life. I don't care about my own stuff. I don't care about my clothing. I don't care about my food. I don't care about anything. Father cares about it all, so I don't need to care about it all. Huh? I don't care. I don't care. Can you say that? I know. I don't care. I've cast all my cares on him. I don't have any more care. He has all my care. I don't care. Huh? Are you with me? Cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Huh? That's the same thing as humble yourself in the mighty hand of God. And he will exalt you at due time. Hallelujah. Say, I don't care. Because I cast all my cares on him. Try one more time. Let's get this to be a little more believable. I want this to be just a little more believable. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As long as you're working, as long as you're fighting, as long as you're trying to make it happen, God can't do anything. He's not sharing his glory. He's not going to participate and mix it up with the arm of flesh. Stop. Watch what God would do. Stand still and behold the salvation of your God. This is the way it works. Stop. Stop everything. Stand there and praise him. Lift up your hands in the holy place. Hallelujah. Mambong jang leng dong bran jela. Sitala langena manjeko ye. Hallelujah. Anybody still feel bad? Those who feel bad left so that they could go feel bad by themselves. Because there was no more place in here to feel bad. The place was saturated with the feel good. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, God's going to get this thing done.
God's going to get this thing done.
Through me.
Through me.
Through us.
Through us.
Amen. Stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ikara sando lo boko nemen de bera saprona. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We're so excited to finally be at the crossroads of getting into the building where we're supposed to be. We did not think we were going to have to be in this room as long as we were. God protected us from all the dust. He gave us the grace to deal with the dispersed, echoey sound. Thank you, Lord. He met us here in this place as we've assembled here in this hall with his goodness. He brought forth strength into our lives. And now we're gonna pick up and we're going to move over there. And we need as many of you to help us as possible. There was a time in my life where, as the pastor of the church, I did everything. If there was any work to be done, I did the work. If there was any moving to be moved, I did the moving. If there was any chairs put in place, I did the chairs. If there was an offering, I took up the offering. I sang the song. I preached the sermon. And I was faithful in my ministry, and the Lord gave me more. But I was also faithful before that in ministry that was not mine. It was another man's ministry. And I gave my whole heart to it. And as long as I was on other ministries, the Lord had ministries, I faithfully served those ministries. You know, when I was in Calvary Chapel, I faithfully served in Calvary Chapel and loved being in Calvary Chapel in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s. And other ministries, served in Assemblies of God ministries, served in helps ministry to my father in his ministry. And, you know, as you serve in ministry, there's a blessing, there's a reward. It's, you know, if nobody sees you and nobody says anything to you about what you've done, look, my goodness, don't think that it ever goes unnoticed by the Lord, because it doesn't. And, you know, we're so blessed to see, you know, the youth and the children even mopping the floors and painting the walls and all the other stuff. And those of you that have really spent a lot of time laboring, thank you so much. Thank you for preparing a place for us to be able to assemble ourselves before the presence of the Lord and take a hold of a divine provision that He's made available to a church who will seek Him the way that He designed, the way that He fashioned. He's left nothing to our imagination. I'm going to say it one more time. He's nothing left, nothing for us to figure out or to discover. He's told us exactly what He wants us to do. Yeah. If we will do it His way, we will have His results. I want to encourage all of you. Go onto our website. You can see we have written copious amounts of literature on there. It would take you at least a year to read everything on there if you diligently read 3 or 4 hours a day. You still probably wouldn't get it done. As much information as we have on there, just the Word of God, ministering the Word of God. A lot of it is about what God expects to go on in His church. Give yourself to understanding these things, that the Word of God may have preeminence and rule your heart and rule your mind and rule your emotions and rule your attitudes and rule the things that go on in your desires, so that you can agree with God and hook up in faith for the things that He's purposed for us to do together. My goodness, we'll tear Satan's kingdom down this place. Amen. We'll tear His kingdom down in this place. I don't know how it's all going to come down, but I was telling the evangelist today, it was telling me about a place, and Cuba just opened up to him, and I said, you know, look, here's what the Lord showed me. He showed me some time ago that we're going to have to start doing in America what we've done overseas. And I know that we can't really hear you, Dave. We can only hear your E string. So it just sounds like a bum, bum. I love music. You know, we just need to try to get it right. But we have to do in America what we've been doing over, you know, most of the great ministries have been done actually overseas. And I heard Reinhardt talk about how the Lord has now laid on his heart to focus upon the United States of America. And how that Peter Youngren now and just so many ministries who are running all over the world are just focusing on America, going from town to town, city to city. You know, I'm willing to do that. But even more, I want to raise up people who can do that. And there ain't no way you can do it without a manifest glory of God in your life. You have to receive an anointing to do it. It's good that you're willing to do it. People may be willing to do it, but you can't go until you're sent. Said, how should they hear unless there be a preacher? And how can there be a preacher unless he be sent? Because the last thing, first of all, you're going to have faith for the finances, because it's going to take resources to get it done, to do it right. That's already a level of participating in the anointing that is essential, that every person knows how to go into that connection with God to be able to see that supplied. Then, for the gospel to be preached, for it to have the impact that we would be going and doing these things for in the first place, is it's going to have to be on the level of Romans 15:19, where Paul said that he fully preached the gospel with mighty signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. Mighty signs and wonders, power of the Holy Ghost, there's going to have to be an anointing for that. So I want to participate with raising people up. Now, all you got to do is plug into the church now. All you got to do is do it God's way. I don't care who you are.
I don't care if you're a man of God or a woman of God. Father's no respecter of persons concerning who he would anoint to go. Mariah Woodworth Edder went like no man was able to go. There is no restriction on this. It's just who's going to go all the way with God. And it begins by your servitude and participation in the midst of the church. I cannot say it enough. You're going to have to get past the things that Satan would try to afflict you with in your attitudes and intimidation. In the areas of guilt and condemnation. You could get past that mess. It'd keep you from going forward. So you just took up with me concerning these things that Father's purpose for us to do. Let's just do it His way. Let's just make church about Him. Touch in heaven, nothing else. Sit. Let's make the song about the glory of God falling. I don't make the song about the glory of God falling on you. You with me? I make the song about the glory of God falling on me. Are you with me?
Yes.
If you'll make the song about the glory of God falling on you, because the song is a means by which you're touching heaven, I'm telling you, the place will be lit up. It'll be lit up. Whether there's a music instrument up there or not. Huh? Froggy and the three chipmunks could be leading worship and be glorious. Are you with me? Hallelujah. I'm telling you, it's true. Some of you look like you just cannot smile if nothing. I mean, I'm mad. I'm angry. I'm not going to smile. Smile. Be happy. Just be happy. Just smile. Just be happy. I believe that what happens is the Holy Ghost walks around in the midst of a church service looking for the happiest person, and there is where he hangs out. I believe that. He's not going to come sit down and suffer with you. He doesn't do suffer. He's not going to come down and be sad with you. He doesn't do sad. Amen. He does blessed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody said, how about the sufferings of Christ? Yeah, but he counted all joy. Amen. So it's different, isn't it? That's different, isn't it? See, I'm just talking to you like this, and you think that I'm just giving out information. Actually, I'm doing what Peter did at Cornelius' house, and I know, and I'm expecting the same kind of results that while he spake, the Holy Ghost fell on them who heard him. That's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing. Let me encourage you to just give God just a little bit of time. Give God a little bit of time. I know some of you spend long hours in the books, in things that really are strongholds of the mind. I know some of you spend long hours in research or doing things in business. I'm going to encourage you to spend a little time. Sit down with the Father about an hour or so. Just give him a little time. Start reading through an epistle. What's going to happen is the Lord's going to see your diligence. He's going to see your heart and your affection. And you're going to discover a manifest presence of God and the glory of God going to start filling your life. It's going to happen. I guarantee you, watch what you, I'm telling you. I'm not talking about filling your time with doing research in the Bible. Talking about sitting down and listening to the Father speak, doing research in the Bible. God wants to research you, man. You need to stop researching Him. Are you with me? You don't need to research. Amen. He needs to be believed. I sit down. I'll give you an example. Today I sit down and I read probably one of the most familiar epistles of the Bible that I know. I mean, the Lord, I devoted myself to memorizing whole books of the Bible in a period of my life. And I sat down and I read an epistle today that is very, very familiar to me. I've read it so much. I mean, when you memorize a whole epistle, you become very familiar with every single word. I've translated every single word in this epistle. But I sat down, sat there, and I just read it. And I got to through chapter 3. Towards the end of chapter 3. And the manifest glory of God came on me so powerfully. It's just Father responding to the love. I'm reading out of love. I'm reading theirs, Papa, to know you, Lord. I'm just reading out of love. He always answers. It takes a while, people. It takes a while for us to grow and mature to where those senses to recognize his presence develops. But do it. Do it. Don't be discouraged. Don't be disappointed with yourself. Don't live in regret. Don't live in the past. Live in the commitment. Live in his help. Papa, thank you so much. I don't want to make anyone's experience something that you need to be feel less than blessed about. I just want to tell you there's always a lot more. Praise God for what he did. I would not know what I know in God today had there not been a beginning in my life somewhere. And maybe that beginning in my life somewhere, it does truly cannot compare to what's going on in my relationship with the Lord today. But every part of it is important. And I'm just saying, there is no reason for you to get lukewarm about God. There's no reason for you to feel like, you know, there's nothing more for you to pursue. There's no real interest there. You're looking for something fun to go and do. You're bored. Bored. Heaven's all heaven's before you. You can experience everything in the realms of glory, never leave your living room. Hallelujah. You will eventually, because the Father will send you out, because more people need to hear. The reason we need to go from town to town, city to city, is because what's going on in many of the churches, and unfortunately, I can almost say the majority of churches, has really not given much place for the Holy Ghost to do anything. And if we're going to see a nation change, we're going to have to go and give the Holy Spirit. We're going to have to have a place where the Holy Spirit has full rights and privileges to do whatever he wants. And an expectation to see signs and wonders and miracles take place, to go into cities and towns and to see the miracles that break open those cities and towns happen. You can do this with your life if you want, or you can be an accountant. A scientist, a policeman, a fireman, a madman, whatever. Choose. You can choose. You choose God, and it doesn't matter what you're doing right now, he's going to promote you. Every businessman that I know that ever took a hold of God got promoted out of their business into the full-time ministry. Yeah, to some degree. God's calling us. God's calling us. Calling us first as a church, collectively to come out of that. He raises up people to go. My petition to you is that every one of you are willing to be sent. You stand in his presence until you hear the Lord say, who will go for us? Who will go for us? Who will go for us?
Amen. Well, we love you. Love you dearly. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to come tonight with an offering to worship the Lord with it. And I know it may be a hardship for many of you. It may be a great sacrifice for many of you. But the Lord's brought us into this place that is really way beyond, you know, what if you counted the financial power, if you would, is way beyond our financial means. And so I know that as we participate with this, the Lord is going to resource. God's going to work miracles. He is going to produce supernatural resources. If you've got to let go. I know everybody can say, look, everybody can say, you know, if you look at my bills, there's no room to wiggle. Yeah, you can say that way. You can say it that way. And you can believe it that way if you want. Or you can just go ahead and reach out beyond yourself and say, yeah, you know what? My finances dictates to me that I have nothing to give. But my heart, in response to God's command, says I am going to give. Amen. Can you see there's two different lords? My finances dictate to me that I have nothing to give. But my heart, in response to God's word, says I'm going to give. Are you with me? Hallelujah. And that's what we do. And we watch God work miracles for us. We hook up with his word. Say the simplest acts of obedience. Create the greatest miracles of faith.
Can you feel the anointing? My hand's got to go up because I have the anointing so on me. I'm not doing this out of just some kind of ritual. I'm telling you, my hands go up because I just get captivated by the anointing. It's true. I'm not kidding you. I'm like stuck. Really, I'm stuck. I'm stuck in a realm of divine power and glory. Hallelujah. And I want you to get stuck over here too. I think that felt so good. I should have us say it one more time. Just simply say this with me. Say the smallest act of obedience.
Result in the greatest miracles of faith.
Somebody said, prove that to me. Your salvation. Smallest act of obedience. Call upon the name of Jesus. Greatest miracle of faith. And you should be saved. Amen. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Stay in the manifest presence of Jesus. Stay in this glory realm. You don't have to go out of it. Amen. Wherever the Lamb goes, follow him. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the anointing on Rob. Thank you, Lord, for blessing him, spirit, soul, and body. Hallelujah. Prosper him, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, with a long life. Cindy needs to have him around. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If anybody needs prayer for anything, I'm here to pray for anybody who wants prayer. Hallelujah. Na ne se na nangi na no sana na ni ala na na mani andu la siti ana na kana ni ati andu do hanai. Hallelujah. Happy in Jesus. What do you want me to pray for?